Welcome. You're tuning into the front lines of the battle for spiritual liberation, and at times it certainly does feel like a battle. In fact, a lot of the times it feels that way. I was very surprised by a terrible dream last night, nightmare that woke me up, and it's still reverberating. So surprising, because coming off of a couple days of a pinnacle of clarity. So I'm trying to understand this and get past this one. It has something to do with the fear of the loss of physicality. Instead of battling with it, I'm trying to employ the way that we work here. As I know I'm already free. I know I'm already not the body. I already know that I'm already not the body. I already know I'm already not the body, or I already know I'm not the body. Or something, I'm already know that I'm already not the body. I already know this. Don't struggle with the fears. Simply state that you're already past them. In fact, they were never a problem. Okay, don't say that you solve the problem. This is the trouble. This is making illusions real and then getting rid of them, which is not possible, actually. So what we say is that it's already resolved, it's already done, and it was actually never a problem, never a real problem at all. Because it's already solved prior to any struggle with solving it. It just bypasses the whole situation. We don't have to get rid of illusions, make them real and get rid of them. We just have to assert what is true, actually. And that is, I am not a body. I am free. I am still spirit as God created me. I already know that I'm already not a body. I already know that I'm already not a body. And I already know everything has this different appearance. Already has this different appearance. Everything already has this different appearance. There's no physicality, so to speak. I already know there's no physicality. I already know that there's already no physicality at all. I already know that there's already no world at all. I already know there's already no trap at all. No trap of physicality. This is how I see to succeed at the situation. One thing I can guarantee is going out at it the other way doesn't work. It doesn't work. Having tried that most of my life, it doesn't work. So you have to preempt the entire situation. Preempt it and say, yeah, I know that I already know that there's never been any world. I already know that there's never been anybody. It was just a hallucination. I already know that there's never, I already know there's already never been a world. I already know that there's already never been a body. I already know there's already never been any physicality. It's never existed. I already know it's never existed. It's already never existed. See, already never existed. I mean, that takes us doing something entirely out of the picture. Remember, I need to do nothing, and there's nothing I can do about that. So, in our conceptuality, take the whole issue of doing anything off the board. It's no longer an option. I know that already physicality has never existed. I already know that already there's never been a world. I already know that already there's never been a body. I already know that already there's never been physicality, actually. It's true. It's true. Been a dream of it, but that dream is still completely spiritual. There's no real actual physicality at all to any of this. Now, in this dream I had, What happened here? One moment. Okay, but the power supply was not properly connected. In this dream, it was terrible. Some crazy murderer was in the neighborhood, and was after like two people, and there was like one, and then I said maybe I'm the next. I think I'm the next, and I was fleeing, or at least someone was fleeing. I was aware of. I was sort of watching the scenario. And that somebody was desperately looking for a place to hide, tried to change their clothes. They couldn't find any way to change their clothes. And they realized that this terrible lunatic had seen them killing someone. And that they knew, you know, there's evidence. They knew there's a witness to it. They're after them now. And it's just like horrible, you know, just extremely horrible scenario. But in the daytime, I was thinking about it, I said, you know, that may have been the picture from the standpoint, the perspective from the one who was thought they were being pursued, which was physicality. It was somebody that in the dream had represented someone, physicality, no question about it. And that may be how they saw it. Okay, but there may be another way to look at the situation, and that is not a crazed murderer, but rather a dedicated practitioner of truth who's recognizing, hey, this has never been true. Hey, this has never been true. It's not killing anything or like, no. It's saying that something has never actually taken place. That's not making an illusion true and then killing it, you see. So it could have been just a matter of perspective. Now, in the dream, I was sort of watching the side of this physicality and how it was looking at it and thinking that, oh, you know, they're right about this. Like, maybe what if I could took it from the side of the other person, the supposed perpetrator that was terrorizing the neighborhood? Maybe it wasn't that way at all. Maybe there was a liberating. It was a great liberator, actually. Maybe there's two sides to even our dream stories. These exercises certainly do bring about a certain amount of fear, wowness, and there's also some trepidation there. And so it's up to us to don't buy into that perspective that's coming from the body, as if the body were real. Looking from that perspective, we think, oh, this activity is terrible. It's actually trying to destroy physicality. No, it's saying, I already know that there's already never been any physicality. It's never been. This is not, awakening from the dream is not destroying the figures in a dream. It's just saying, oh, all these figures are just dream figures. There's no reality to them. There's no real physicality to anything. It's not this.
Did you walk? Yeah.
One moment, please. So I already know that there's already never been any physicality. I already know that there's never been any dream. A world. Never been a world. So we're not saying the world is real, we're getting rid of it. We're saying that there's only been a dream world that only exists as a dream, not as a reality at all. And that seeing this, we realize there is no real physicality at all. And so that we can say there is no real world at all. There are no real bodies at all. Never have been. When you see something's just a figment of a dream, then you can say it's never been real. You don't have to, like, follow the figure throughout the whole dream and keep dreaming. So, well, when was it real and when was it not? Or when did it become unreal? Or, you know, it doesn't, once you see it's just a dream, it doesn't matter what the odyssey that any dream figure goes through. It's still 100% just a figment of our imagination, a dream figment of our imagination. It never changes at all. So it doesn't really matter what's happening in the world, does it? That doesn't change the fact that it's a dream. It doesn't change that at all. So there's nothing we need to evaluate in this world at all. There's nothing we need to evaluate at all. If there isn't any physicality, I already know. Yeah, I already know. There's already no physicality whatsoever. So if this is true, then what do we need to evaluate as far as physicality goes? No reason to at all. None whatsoever. So we're looking at the situation from the standpoint of evaluation. We don't need to do any evaluation if what we're saying is true and we are asserting it as if it is. I already know this is true. I already know this is true. This is what's called the leap of faith. And this is what's all important on the spiritual path as far as finishing off. When you're reaching these difficult areas, which I certainly am reaching, is the capacity to continue to take this approach. Do it, because you can run into some very severe fear. I'm doing so great, and boom, yeah, this fear arises. Wow. So we say, yeah, I already know. There's already never been a world. I already know there's never been any physicality. I already know I'm not a body. I am free. I'm still spirit as God created me. You take this position. Not just conceptually, but as much as you, well, first conceptually. You say, okay. Then you say, I try to believe it. You try to believe it. And then you try to feel it. Like, yeah, this is how I feel. But I already feel the certitude. In other words, I already feel this knowing that, I already know. I mean, I already have this feeling, this experiencing, this knowing. I already have this. So, of course, yeah, of course. Yeah, I already know that there's already never any world. Yeah, I already know there's already no physicality whatsoever. Yeah, I already know that there's already no body whatsoever. No body whatsoever. This isn't like getting a hold of a body and saying, body, I hate bodies, I'm going to kill this body, and then if I get rid of this, then I'll get rid of this terrible body. It's saying, yeah, I already know that there's already no bodies whatsoever. There's never been any bodies, never been any physicality. And the leap of faith is to assert this, to conceive it, to believe it, to feel it, and to assert it. That this is already true, you know this. It's in the knowing, not conceptuality. You know it to be true. You already know this to be true. So it's not up for discussion at all. That's why we're using affirmation. This is not a discussion group or a dialoguing here. This is a practicing of affirmations. We're not bringing this into the intellect and discussing it. Well, is it true or is it not true? No. Phase four, you take the leap of faith. It's that simple. If you're going to take phase four, you take the leap of faith. If you want to stay in phase three, then you can, but you're not going to succeed. You will not succeed just staying in phase three. You will continually go over and over and over spiritual information. Look at it this way, look at it that way. Discuss it, pros and cons, in the same way. And maybe you'll be, you know, someone who can recite a lot of spiritual books and phrases and quotes and all these various things. But you're not going to be liberated. So this is the fourth phase here, where we flip the script, we take the leap of faith, and we affirm as if we're simply affirming something we already know. Okay, we are simply affirming that which we already know and are certain of. That's all. We're not discussing certainty. We're not discussing that. We are simply, whatever we say is to affirm the rightness of this practice. Okay, it's this leap of faith that, yeah, I already know that there's already no no bodies, that there's already no physicality at all. I already know that there's already no world. I already know that there's already no world. This is how one practices in phase four. An analogy to phase four, or something that's parallel, you might say, would be the like radical Dzogchen, where teaching, you know, says, you know, drop all the teaching. That kind of, you know, there's something analogous to it. You know, there is this stage you reach where you do take a leap of faith, and it's different now. It's not up for discussion any longer. We know the truth already. Now, of course, the intellect will insist that you cannot know the truth already because it doesn't know. And it thinks that it's the discerner of truth. It is not the discerner of truth. The intellect doesn't lead, it follows, actually. But it's very clever in following in such a boastful way that you think it's leading. But it's not leading. It's never been leading, actually. This is the way we deceive ourselves so severely. Our awareness is so immediate, and then the intellect can jump in with seeing the awareness and react to it, and then act like, you know, it discovered it first. Like, oh, this is what I just discovered. No, it's already, it's reacting to what's already been experienced. So you might say it's commenting on the past. But at any rate, the intellect does not lead. And it actually is incapable of discerning truth, or actually knowing truth. It cannot know truth. The most it can do is bring a high degree of plausibility and likelihood. Okay, it's very likely that this is the truth. But it's like something that's blind. It can't really see it. But it says, you know, I would say, you know, reason tells me this, you know, yeah, this is true. But as Jesus says, that at some point you do have to take this leap of faith that what you know to be true, you don't need the intellect to know it, because it can't. Intellect deals with concepts, and concepts can always be conflated, twisted, distorted, undermined. There's always a degree of uncertainty dealing with symbols. Always. Never can you have certainty with symbols. Because what if someone doesn't agree with you're symbolizing it with this way, and someone says, no, that's not the right way to symbolize it. Well, since symbols are essentially arbitrary, you know, how can you assert it to, well, yeah, this is the right way to symbolize it? And you get immediately this level of conflict and uncertainty is present anytime you're using symbols. So at some point, phase four, you decide to, goodbye. Don't need that. Doesn't work. Don't need it. Why? Because it doesn't work. And that's why. That's all. I'm not judging. This doesn't work. And I don't want to be a symbol of enlightenment. I want to realize, no, I'm already enlightened. See, already enlightenment is before symbols, before symbolization can take place. This is what we're saying. Before any symbolization, conceptualization, reaction can take place, I'm already that. I am already that. So I would just add this to I am that. I am already that. This takes the whole ego, intellect, conceptualization, takes it off the board. And this is this feeling like of consternation when you take the ego off the board like this. You preempt it. This is when you feel this strain within you, which I'm starting to feel right now. As soon as I'm working on this, I start to feel, wow, you know, the ego feels this. It's trying to kill me, you know. No, I'm just preempting the whole situation. No opinion of the ego is needed. I already am that. I am already that. I am already that. When the ego says, well, how can you know? I haven't seen it. as if the ego's first, and if it was true, the ego had already seen it before you knew it. as if conceptualization is prior to experiencing, you see? Vision is post-experiencing, actually. So once again, this is hitting hard. Here comes the wow, which is what we expect when we practice this a priori way of co-opting the ego entirely and saying, yeah, I already know. I already know. This, you're going to develop, you're going to have this wow reaction. You're going to have a reaction. Is that you realize that the ego cannot handle this. And so the ego's upset, and you're saying, wow, it looks like I'm getting the best of the ego here. I mean, wow, this is really working. Wow. So there's the wow. You know, if you look at it only like, oh, it's hurting the poor ego, you know, oh, that's terrible. But you say, oh, the ego's like just fumbling and can't deal with this at all. And you say, great, that's wonderful. And that's the positive wow. See, full stop on this wow. Wow, how wonderful this is. And the ego says, well, you get rid of me, you won't see anything, because the ego thinks that it's the one that's seeing, and experiencing is reacting to the ego's seeing. Conceptualization, the ego thinks conceptualization is first, and experience is after that. So the ego tells us, if we get rid of the ego, we won't be able to experience at all. Okay, there's a complete upside down, backwards lie. But one that intimidates us for sure. So, we keep practicing even though the ego doesn't like it. It tells us, you're crazy, the ego says. You won't be able to experience anything. You'll be annihilated, you know. No, the ego is the reaction. The ego is seeing only the past. The ego just dwells in thoughts and concepts, which are reactions to a past, to an image that's already past. Experiencing is always right now, immediate, already now. Not right now, already now. There's a distinction, I find this very important distinction. In just a way of saying this, if you say right now, yeah, now, it doesn't seem to bother my the ego. The ego says, oh yeah, that's cool. But if you say no, already now, it's already now, then this bothers the ego greatly, very disturbing. Oh, panicky, I would say. And this is in the dream. This figure I was watching was like panicky. Very frightened, thinking that its end was near, is being tracked down, and you know, like pursued, has been marked for destruction, and is so frightened. This is part of the reaction we have. The ego says, "Ah, what are you trying to do to me?" You know. No, it's already now. Experience is already now, not just now, but it's already now. The experience is already now. Conceptualization just cannot deal with this. And it caused us this consternation, which I call this, and the overall are seeing the consternation and saying, hey, that's great. Wow. This is really working. That's tremendous. Wow. So there is this, the full stop in the wow means don't struggle with the fact that the ego's struggling. Don't help the ego out in its struggles. Don't even just stop with the realization. It's great the ego's struggling. It's great the ego can't get a hold of this. It's great the ego's panicking. And so just full stop in that positive wow. Full stop in the positive wow. Hey, this is great. This is wonderful. And then stand your ground. Don't back off. See, the ego thinks that its interpretations are reality, and that it interprets us, and then we accept its interpretations, and that's our reality. Well, there might be the reality, imaginary reality, but that's not the reality God created. It's a fake reality, you might say, but how real is a fake reality? It's not real at all. So yeah, this is heated up, the wow, strongly already. It doesn't take much now to stir it up, but we're actually digging into it very severely here. And the ego's getting real nervous. The ego thinks it's being pursued by a maniac. Right? Trying to kill the ego and kill reality, kill the identity. Because the ego thinks that it's comes first. Instead of actually it's all only a reaction. Already this burn is here very strongly, as it has been the last several days, and incredibly strong. Like I said, the ego is like trapped, like a wild animal. It seems like it's holed up, it's frantic. It's okay, we don't struggle. We don't struggle with that. Just say, great. Wow, that's great. For a moment. So we can be clear. I know I already know that there's already not no world. It's already never been a world. I already know that there's already never been any physicality. Just saying this just produces a tremendous reaction. Okay, yeah, I already know that there's already never been any physicality. Yeah, I already know that there's never been any world. Yeah. Just be calm. Even cavalier, just be easy, just breathe like a breeze. Yeah, I already know. Sure, of course. Yeah, I already know that there's already never been any physicality. Already never been any physicality. This removes it, a step removed from any possibility, you see, of the ego. Takes it off the board and puts it at a distance, really, at a distance. Yeah, I already know that there's already never been any world. Now, the great thing about this is you can feel that this hits hard, this type of practice. You know, I always, in the many years, I started really practicing when I was maybe... maybe 20 years, when I was 20 years old, something like that. Various practices, and it really started, you know, intensely practicing. But what I found was that none of the practices really, I never felt like they were really working that well. I mean, I started out practicing when I was 18. The earliest so far I can remember. Maybe there was something before that. But I was reading a lot before then. considering a lot, but as far as actually trying to just practice, yeah, 18. That was when the Maharishi Mahesh Yogi TM, Transcendental Meditation. Here's your mantra. Sit in meditation and say the mantra, okay. Got my mantra. Tried it out, you know, 18. But since then I've been practicing various ways. Never did I ever feel it was really working, which is why it's hard to keep doing it. But the great thing about this type of practicing is almost right away, you can tell this is just hitting super hard. Something is just getting, you know, nailed by this. I mean, it is just, you have to stop. It's so strong. So for me, that's great. You know, and I know there's so many spiritual practitioners who say, I've been practicing my whole life, and I just don't really feel I've really gotten anywhere. Or, yeah, I mean, that's pretty much join the club. Join the club. But this practicing is the hammer. You can feel it. Boy, you can feel the reverberations. Someone is not just tapping. This is hammering. And something's getting hammered here. Just say it a few times, really believe it, and from, you know, the practice it the right way is you're asserting what you already know to be true. There's no doubt about it. There's no intellect involved at all here. We're just asserting what we already know to be true. I already know, sure, yeah, I already know that there's already never been any world. I already know that there's already never been any physicality. So you start practicing this way, and you feel, wow, you know, just wow. Gone are the days where we can spend years, you know, in some practice and just say, hey, I did it a couple years, it's great, but, you know, really no change. A lot of that stuff is designed sort of just trying to de-stress you a little bit. Make you feel good about yourself. Hey, I'm doing a spiritual practice. Sort of calm you down, try to stay centered in various things, which are, you know, they're fine as far as they go. But this, the great thing is, you know, I can feel This is working on something, extremely so, profoundly so. In fact, it's so effective it can hardly stand it, which is why we do this, you know, full stop and the wow, and give ourselves some time. Don't run away from it. The intensity is quite strong. It's like our ego is like trembling like a leaf in the wind here. It's like a hurricane that's blowing, and the leaf is trying to stay on the tree, and it's just shaking and trembling. It's just like, wow. But then again, we're just concerned with standing our ground here, full stop in the wow, and just don't try to evaluate it too much. Just say, okay, great. But from the beginning of this to now, I find it's getting more stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger. I already know. This attitude, yes, I already know. Yes, I already know that there's already never been any physicality anywhere. And to the extent that you hold that as an affirmation of knowing, this really kicks up the ego. That's why I say full stop in the wow. Do not bring it into the intellect or conceptualization or anything at all. Don't bring anything at all. You're asserting something that you know. You know this is true. Yeah, I already know. Yeah, I already know that I know. I know I already know is the full version. I know I already know. Yeah, I know I already know that there's already never been any physicality. Yeah, I know that I already know that there's already never been any physicality. And the short version would be, yeah, I already know that there's already no physicality whatsoever. Yeah, I already know that there's already no physicality. I already know that already physicality has never existed. Know that there's already no evidence of the existence of physicality whatsoever. Yes, I already know that there's already no evidence for the existence of any world whatsoever. Now, it helps, it seems as though, to have some sort of teacher helping this. Because of such a statement, obviously, if you try to get someone else to agree with you, you're not going to find any luck in that, are you? To say, yeah, I already know that there's already never been any world whatsoever. Yes, I already know. Sure, yeah, I already know that there's already no trace of evidence for any world whatsoever. So which one of your friends is going to be right there with you and assert the same thing with total certainty, but the same certainty, yeah. Good luck, you know, finding someone like that, right? Now, so this is why I'm saying that we're being helped. This is why I'm saying we're being helped. Otherwise, I don't believe it's possible to assert this publicly like this, and even privately, not publicly, even that would be, I think, too much. So I believe we are getting help. I can say, I know. Yeah, I already know that we're already getting tremendous amount of help. Yeah, I already know that we're already getting tremendous amount of help with this. That's a very positive assertion. Wonderful. So the reason that this is being done like this on YouTube is to help others out, because to do this fourth phase is it's extremely helpful to have some teachers, some helpers with this one, because you're shaking like the ego's shaking like a leaf, the ego's screaming, the ego, I mean, you know, the ego's so scared and easy to back off, right? Yeah, I already know. Yes, I already know that there's already not a shred of evidence for any existence of physicality whatsoever. Now, the teachers will absolutely agree with you. Absolutely agree with you. Whereas people of the world, good luck trying to find even one that will agree with you. Right? They might say, wow, and they'll go into the intellect, right? Teachers don't need to go into the intellect. They'll say, I already know. The teacher will say, yeah, I already know you're absolutely right. You're already absolutely right. I already know that what you already know is already, perhaps already known. I already know that what you already know is already known. So when you start talking about not a no evidence whatsoever, this, you know, is where the difference between the third and fourth phase come into play. Because in the third phase, you're not going to be able to, certainly we have teachers helping us that are saying, go for it, you know, go for it. We got your back. We have your back, don't worry. So, phase one, two, and three is possible to do this with self-study or a little bit of help. But I find phase four is when you need the strong help. You need to be backed up on this. Is what we're asserting now is so extraordinary. Yes, I already know that there's already zero evidence for any trace of physicality whatsoever. I already know that there's already no evidence for physicality. I already know there's already no evidence for any world. Which is why we can now realize the whole, you know, guru principle, teacher principles, and such like that, is hitting this fourth phase, needing to take this leap of faith. You can see how it's how it could be very helpful, actually, because we're saying, yes, I already know there's already no trace of any evidence whatsoever for any world, for the existence of any world. I already know there's already no evidence for the existence of any physicality. So this is where the ego will claim you're certifiably insane. In fact, worse, you're some maniac, some terrible homicidal maniac is what the ego will claim. And so that's where, you know, and the ego wants you to get back into your intellect, but get back into your conceptualization, get back into your reacting to what it wants you to react to. Get back in your cage. Another 80 degree day in California. How many days in a row is this now? 80 degrees, maybe five days in a row now. 80 plus. Supposed to stay very nice and like, all the way through the next week or so. Ridiculous. Yeah, we love the great weather, but you know, this summer, and then next fall, we're going to want to flush our toilets too, you know, and if there's no water to flush our toilets, what good is it to have a night, the weather's nice, but we can't flush our toilets. That's not so good. Can't take showers. I talked to irrigation pros today, professionals, and they said it's crazy. I said people are putting in big lawns, so much lawn is going in, sod lawn, you know, all over the place. So what are they thinking? What are they thinking? It's just, it's nuts here. You talk about social experimentation. Just wait and see if we don't get any more rain in California. Just wait and see what happens here. Good Lord. That'll be quite a meditation, collective meditation right there. But we don't want to be distracted by that. You become so addicted to the nice weather here that you don't want it to end. And so you end up hating rain. Get away, cloud, rain. No, we don't want any. And it becomes some sort of self-fulfilling situation of addiction. Everybody out here say, no, we want another day. We don't want these beautiful days to ever end. But, you know, flip side is no water. That doesn't work very good. Welcome to the world. Wow. But yes, I already know. I already know that there's already zero evidence for any world. This is our saving grace. This is the trump card that we have on this world. We do have a trump card. We just have to play it. And so this fourth phase, we're playing the trump card. And the ego says, you can't do that, we say. I already did. It's too late, I already did play it. It's finished, it's already over with. I already played it. So this seems to be very traumatic for the ego, but we can say, yes, I already know that I'm already free of all trauma. So there's no trauma, I'm already free of all trauma. I am not trauma, I am free, I'm already free. I already know that I am not trauma, I'm already free. I'm already free, how can there be trauma if I'm already free? I'm already free. There's no trauma. So we're doing the full stop and the wow here, standing our ground, understanding that the ego is, we're quite shocked. Ultimately, we're actually viewing the situation and assuming that the ego is shocked, assuming all this is taking place, it is plausible, this is how the ego's feeling, so we're feeling it. But but the ego's really is not feeling anything. It's just, it's in our mind. It's all in our mind. All this is just in our mind, actually. Yes, I already know that there's already no zero evidence for any physicality whatsoever. Yes, I already know that there's absolutely zero evidence for any world, already zero evidence for any world whatsoever. Yes, I already know that there's already no trace that any world ever existed. Yes, I already know that there's already no trace that any physicality has ever existed. No trace. Yes, I already know that there's already no trace, no evidence that any physicality has ever existed. Yes, I already know there's absolutely not a trace of any evidence that any world, a world has ever existed. Yes, I already know that this world is already appearing as spontaneously arising, indescribably vast, pure spaciousness. It's already arising as that. It's already that. Already arising. Yes. I am already that. Yes, all is already that. Yes, all. Yes, I already know that all is already that. Yes, I already know that all is already that. So, of course, this type of practicing, it feels like we're being scourged in some way. It's like, wow, but it's a good thing. Taking our medicine. We're taking our medicine is what we're doing. So don't shy away from that at all. Just, okay, great. Another sweat lodge experience. And maybe the dreams won't be so good. Maybe there'll be some strain in your life, but it's like, as Sri Nisargadatta Maharaj once advised, saying, when you're finishing off the path, so to speak, and you're really into it, he said, sometimes the body reacts, doesn't feel so good. Others, it doesn't really bother the body so much, but sometimes the body doesn't feel so great. He says, don't stop, keep doing it. He even said, even if it causes your body to die, don't stop. That's Maharaj saying that. But of course, he was saying that to somebody who was already very sick, very ill. And they said, what should I do? Because the feeling, maybe I only have a year to live, or I'm really, you know, I got nothing to lose. And he said, just go for it. And if the body doesn't get ill, this is ill, he says, that's okay, don't worry about it. Even if the body dies, he says, don't worry about it, that's fine. Well, this is very well taken. Here, we're not trying to have the body die, believing that we can certainly do it without the body dying or passing away, whatever. No longer speed functioning the way that we imagine that is functioning. Or if you feel some strain, maybe you can take it easy and not do it for so long. You know, or a little bit, do a little bit, and then back off, a little bit, back off, a little bit, back off, like that. You can absolutely do it that way, too. I'm just trying to do it real fast. Being aware of the troubles and travails to come in this world. You don't want to be vulnerable to that. So, yes, I know I'm already that. Yes, I know I'm already that. Yes, I know I'm already now. Yes, I know I'm already now. Now, we might think that because we're sort of feeling like this causes such strain and that we're not making progress, I would say, no, it's the opposite. We're going so fast, we're feeling the strain. Now, in A Course in Miracles, when Jesus, starting out with the exercise, Jesus said, if you start to feel some strain, back off, you know, back off a little bit. You don't have, and then others, he says, you might feel a little bit of strain doing this, says that's okay. So to start out with, you know, when people start doing, you know, phase 1, 2, and 3, they don't strain themselves too much because it worries them. You know, oh, am I beginning sick? Or the ego, well, yeah, the ego's bothered, it's upset, and you're afraid of that. Whereas here, you know, we're no longer afraid of the ego's upset so much. We're standing our ground here. Because, of course, yes, I already know that there's already no evidence of physicality. And you can see how third phase and fourth phase need to be kept apart. Because this will drive the third phasers crazy. You know, they'll just throw all sorts of sophisticated intellectualisms at you to try and prove that you're off your rocker a little bit, you've gone astray. So the sophisticated third phasers, you know, if they get into a fourth phase situation, they're going to argue with you and say, hey, let me help you out, I think you've gone astray here, and you know, blah 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 blah, and throw name drop this and name drop that, and it's, you know, they'll do their best to get you back on track as from the standpoint of how they see it. So, fourthly, this is why, like in Radical Dzogchen, it says don't share this information publicly so much. And at the same hand, like putting a video up on YouTube, like reading Longchenpa, this is entirely something that anyone can either pay attention to or not, and nobody's forcing them whatsoever. So it's a little different than if you're like in a teaching situation, some teacher is teaching you this and saying, do these practices, and you have a cultural pressure on you, you renunciate, you depend upon your room and board and shelter maybe for doing this, and, you know, there's too much pressure. Where just putting a taping out, the Holy Spirit's in charge. If someone's interested, not interested, they say, not that interested. Well, I can't quite get this, or whatever. You know, this is interesting, but yeah. But, you know, the same with these videos here. It's only those who really, you know, who get it are really going to practice it. But certainly, in a formal situation, you wouldn't want to mix the fourth phase with the third. It's going to the third phase, or first, second, and third. The first phasers will kind of just like, I don't know what to make of it. Yeah, maybe they say, that's not true or something, but they don't really shrug their shoulders. And second phasers might get freaked out. Third phasers will get very, very indignant, maybe, and think that, wow, I got to compassionately help you, intervention here, this. So, yeah, the fourth phase is a phase unto itself, that's for sure. And from the standpoint of the third phase, you just can't do the exercise because it keeps dragging the intellect into it. The whole point of this leap of faith is that leave the intellect behind, it's no longer involved. It's no longer involved really at all here. Because I already know that there's already no evidence for any world. I already know there's already no evidence for any physicality. End of story. Just an affirmation, statement of fact. And then we don't relieve the ego's suffering by jumping in and using the intellect. Say, oh, this poor ego, okay, let's talk about this, let's intellectualize this, let's discuss this. Let's this, you know, oh, the ego says, oh, great, wow, you know, I thought you were going crazy or something. No, let the ego think we're going completely nuts. See? Let the ego say we're homicidal maniacs, going completely crazy, out to kill it. You know, let the ego, don't contest that. Don't contest it. There's already no evidence of any ego, actually. I already know there's already no evidence for anybody. No evidence for anybody. I already know. There's already no evidence of anybody. See, the body's the ego's chosen idol. Without the body, there's no ego, really. So we say that, the ego doesn't like that. Yes, I already know that there's already no body, no evidence of any body. And the ego says, you're joking, right? I already know. There is no evidence whatsoever for any body, no trace of any evidence. There's ever been any body whatsoever. And the ego screaming, he's certifiably insane, he's certifiably insane. And so, yeah, fourth phase teaching. In Tibetan Buddhism tradition, there's a Dzogchen, radical Dzogchen. These teachings are only given out to those who are mature enough to handle it. But keep in mind that their situation was very much a monastic situation. The culture was a monastic culture. You had people at a young age be renunciate, be part of the monastic culture, and that's their whole life. And so if you say, hey, you need to do these teachings, they feel obligated, they have to do this, and that can cause severe problems for them, for sure. But here, the situation is nothing like that whatsoever. We don't have any idea how pervasive it was, how all important it was. You know, the various different degrees there in the monastic colleges of Tibet, you know, and universities and training, and how all important, all status, all importance, everything was wrapped up into it. And so you cannot just pass these teachings out under those circumstances. It puts too much pressure on people. They certainly could get sick because the ego is going to rebel and say, I'm going to make you sick so you can't practice. Look what happened to me when I started practicing this. This dreadful illness came upon me. Scary. It's still lingering around, trying to come back all the time. So, yeah, but for me, I just you know, say, well, I'm going to keep practicing. This is going to go away. No problem. I know it. So, but, you know, other people around me say, hi, you know, we're scared. This is in trouble. You know, So it's even better not to say anything, but you know, if you really stick, it's hard not to hide it. But my attitude is all, don't worry, this is just a reaction to these exercises or whatever, to the overall path, but reaction, the ego's feeling very threatened. So it's time to take refuge in sickness and saying, you know, this proves that you can't, there is evidence of the body and physicality and blah, blah, blah. And I say, I already know. And you're not trying to argue with the ego or this comment is not directed at the ego, this practice, not at all. This affirmation is directed at yourself. You're just reminding yourself of the truth, that's all. You're not addressing the ego at all. Yes, I already know that there's already no evidence whatsoever for physicality. Yes, I already know there's already no evidence whatsoever for any body. Yes, I already know there's already zero evidence for any world. We're just reminding ourselves of this. That's it. The ego, we're not even paying any attention to the ego. Well, dark now outside, completely dark. So in Tibetan Buddhism, it's called samaya, something like that, samaya. dare share these teachings under... They say, if you share these teachings, you will be eternal, cast into eternal hell and never escape. You know, they try to, you know, scare you that way. They say, don't do it. And again, in this Western situation culture, where we feel free to pick and choose anything we want to, and we don't feel beholden to anybody, then we can just discard this. I mean, if you don't want to do these practices, then you'll just discard these practices, discard me. I don't have any authority, you know, to make people think they have to practice. But imagine in Tibet, where the whole culture is completely wrapped up in the authority of the gurus, and you get some great radical Dzogchen guru, where people will, if they say throw yourself off a cliff, they'll throw themselves off a cliff without even thinking about it, basically, right? I mean, this is the faith they have. And so if these teachers tell them, hey, this is what you have to practice, they will try and practice it. And even if it kills them, they'll do it. We don't have that situation here. If people don't want to do something, they'll say, that guy's a nut, forget it. What an idiot. You know, that's it. So in some ways, that's helpful in some ways. Yeah. There's pros and cons of every situation, isn't there? Of course, the flip side of that is that there's a lot of success in Tibetan Buddhism. A lot of success because they followed these admonitions. Many were able to go through the earlier phases 1, 2, and 3 and get to the fourth phase and succeed at it. Yeah. So within that sort of situation is understandable. Samadhi is understandable. If we were in that situation, we'd probably agree with it. So yeah, why? Because it's all set up. So you know, when those who mature, they will get it. They'll get the help. There's all these gurus, all the teachings, all there already for them and everything. And it's all, you know. So yeah, no problem. But it's difficult to know how to teach here in the West, for sure, right? Very difficult. I still don't know exactly, you know, how it would be possible at all. Whether these teachings should be given out in a book or not, or even talked about one-on-one to some, you know, some person, that might put too much pressure on them. And then it can come back to you, because the ego starts freaking out, say, hey, you're a homicidal maniac. And they say, well, the teacher must be a homicidal maniac. What are they doing telling me that there's no evidence? This is crazy, you know, they're trying to annihilate themselves, blah, blah, blah. And it can come backlash, you know, that kind of thing too. So it's interesting. Well, I'll find out the answer to it. At least we're getting clearer and clearer and clearer. What's that insect? Weird. Clearer and clearer and clearer about this. What is that? There's still... I'm not supposed to touch my face and stuff, but there's an insect crawling all over. At least it certainly feels like that. One of our like automatic reactions is that there's some insect crawling on our face or hair, like we all react to brush it off. That's a real test. That's something that they talk about, all the different techniques that have developed in the Eastern world and in the Western world to a lesser extent. They do all sorts of stuff. You know, they put them sit on an anthill or something and just let all the ants crawl all over them, you know, just to practice not even reacting in the slightest bit. And you can certainly learn to do that, absolutely. Anyone can, if that's what they want to do. I don't know where the insect is now. That's weird. Most definitely, there are times when suddenly you feel like there's an insect walking on your hair, on the side of your hair, on your forehead. And I'm not really sure if there's one there or not. It certainly feels like it. There's certainly little flying insects around here now, but I don't know. Obviously, there's some in the third phase who sort of are enjoying sort of some sort of seniority in the third phase, some notoriety, some, you know, self-importance, and they don't want there to be any fourth phase because they're not in it. And people are aware, oh, there's a fourth phase higher than the third. You know, that where does their status go? You know. So they like to drag fourth phasers back into the third phase and say, "Nah, you haven't even finished the third phase yet because you haven't resolved these intellect, you know, these disputes." And we say, "There is no, we're not worried about resolution of any of those disputes. We're simply stating what we know is already true." I'm not saying how do we get rid of a world. We already know. I already know that there's already zero evidence that there's a world whatsoever. I already know there is no world. Yeah, I already know there's already is no world whatsoever. So when you get into this fourth phase and able to do these practices and get more and more used to them, then you know you're leaving the third phase behind and you're not so vulnerable to it. Because so many have set up shop just because they can in the third phase. It seems to, you know, have your cake and eat it too, that you still have the ego, but you think that you're smarter than the ego. Something like that. Or you're outsmarting the ego. You're outsmarting physicality. No, I already know that there's already no physicality. You see, they may be thinking they're outsmarting the ego, but we're saying we've already outsmarted the ego. This is the difference between phase four and phase three. Phase three is there's a tremendous effort to outsmart the ego, to think that you're outsmarting the ego and you can outsmart the ego. Phase four is where you affirm, I know I'm already outsmarted the ego. I already did it. And therefore there is no ego. So I don't have to explain how I did it to the ego. And I don't want you to waste my time explaining how I did it to myself, because, you know, that's not needed. It's already done. So that's it. There's there's no intellectual prize. You give up the intellectual prize and that's not the whole thing. So we don't allow ourselves to slouch here, because we're no slouches. That is for sure. Sometimes you need to sleep. I had to sleep 2 hours during the daytime today. I was so completely wiped out. The nightmare woke me up at 4 in the morning. Went to bed at 1 o'clock in the morning, woke up at 4. Yeah, it was a very nervous, frightful state for a long time. So I had to take 2 hours of rest. So sometimes you have to take some rest. If you really feel, wow, this is, I'm weary, take a nap. Don't try to power through it with caffeine. Not at this phase. See, this phase is too severe. If you think, oh, this temper, let me power through it with caffeine, you're gonna get in trouble doing that. You gotta monitor how you feel. And you need a rest, take a rest. This is serious business here. Third phase, maybe, second, third, maybe use caffeine to try to outsmart the ego by trying to, you know, stimulate your thinking and conceptualization, which caffeine certainly does do. Smoking, caffeine, drugs, whatever. And so you think, oh, I'm outsmarting the ego. But remember, in this phase, fourth phase, it's, yeah, I already know. I've already outsmarted the ego. So we're not trying to stimulate the mind, the thinking. No, we're just resting in resting. It's already done. I've already outsmarted the ego. So this is not the thing you can power through with drugs. If people are addicted to caffeine, you know, try to minimize as much as possible. Some people, it's just part of their lives, you know, and so minimize it. Don't try to power through it with caffeine. Maybe just do what you normally do, whatever you do in your life, what your patterns are. But when you feel this, you know, weary, and you don't try to say, hey, I need to outsmart the ego here, let me power through this. No, because we're asserting we've already done it. So we certainly don't want to get into some hyper-doing mode with caffeine. And for those who don't use stimulants, caffeine, don't get started. Now, if there's an emergency, then okay. Like I took drank a Coca-Cola last week when I felt I couldn't drive anymore. Now, I could have got off the freeway and rested, yeah. But then you're under the pressure to get somewhere. Oftentimes, you know, someone's waiting for you and deliver something, and so I said, wow, but you know, don't make a habit of it. there's a temptation there. Say, like, well, if I could just power through this, I'd be finished. But keep in mind, I know I've already finished. I know I've already finished. Sure, yeah, I know that I've already finished, that I'm already free. There's already no physicality. There's already no world. All of that is already gone, without a trace. Yeah, I already know there's already zero evidence for any world. We just give time to relax and settle into this. The ego's freaking out, of course, and we're saying, okay, that's great, fine. Not trying to power through anything too much here. See, with caffeine, drugs, you might take stimulants and say, I think I can finish this right now. And go like 48 hours straight, don't even sleep, just stay wired for maybe three days or something, and just constantly repeating this, just intensely, and put yourself into this. Well, that might freak your ego out so badly, you could end up with some kind of episode from that. You could get paranoid. If you don't succeed what you're trying to succeed at, and it's possible that you won't really that way, then you could end up in a very paranoid condition, actually, very much so. This is what I warn people against. I say drop the drugs, drop the stimulants. If you are used to, again, I did say everyone should cut out all caffeine, but I know people aren't doing that. So just stay in your normal life. You have a cup in the morning or something. Just stay with your normal routine, okay? If you can't drop it, don't try to power through it. Don't try to power through this with stimulants. You really could end up and I've been up front with this. I'll always say, hey, do not use caffeine. Do not try to power through any of this. Absolutely not. Now, if people decide that they're going to do it anyway, that they were going to do it anyway. I mean, all I'm doing is say, don't do it. It's just like telling somebody, stop smoking or don't do this. If they don't listen to you, that's their own fault. What can you do? You can't force people not to, their behavior. They say, I can do anything I want to do. If you try your best and say, don't do this, this is going to be very problematical, and people do it anyway, how can you be blamed? It's their own, desire to power through it, feeling that they need to power through it. Now, what I'm saying is, hey, you see, the problem is third phasers don't realize there is a fourth phase, so they think the third phase is it, and since it's not working, they feel that they have to power through it somehow. They don't realize there's this fourth phase. So the saving grace for so many people, I feel, is the realization there is this fourth phase. And don't panic in the third phase thinking that this is it. You're stuck. Somehow it's not working. You can't finish. And you got to somehow power through it in some way. Stimulate yourself in some way. Power through it. No, you don't have to at all. Just keep practicing. Keep practicing. Keep practicing. Mature, 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 mature. At some point, you'll be able to do this leap of faith. Yeah. So getting this information out of the world, I feel, is super helpful to many who otherwise might have many mental problems, actually. Because if you get stuck you know, somewhere and feel you need to then force the issue with the ego. The ego is still very powerful in our minds as far as our belief in it can be. And so if the ego thinks that you're insane, it's going to act that out and put you in an insane asylum, actually. You know, it can do that. It really can. It can make you be paranoid. Absolutely. All sorts of stuff. So you just have to realize, oh, as you see, in mature monastic cultures, for instance, the fourth phase is there. All the teachers, the top teachers, they know it's there. And everybody kind of realizes there are these higher secret teachings, you know, that if you're mature enough, that you can get those. And so they don't panic. They don't try to force things. They just say, okay, if I get there, I get there. That's great. Whereas here in the West, we're not aware of this, hardly aware of this at all. And so we reach the third phase and think that's it. And since it isn't it, we think we're missing, and we think the missing link is that somehow we have to power through it, we got to force it. And so then you try to force this on yourself, and the ego still being very strong in your belief, will freak out and say you're a homicidal maniac. And then you'll think that there's, project that, and you'll think that there's some extreme, you're in some extreme danger and all this kind of stuff. This is a trouble, there's no question. I've actually run into some people like that, who either are paranoid or actually are homicidal maniacs. The ego, you know, has told them that that's how the only way they can be safe is they have to strike first. You know, strike first against, you know, like that. So that is a problem. That is an issue. So this is a huge help for the world to gradually realize there is this final phase like this for mature practitioners. Huge relief to those who have been stuck. You know, they can get out of mental hospitals, get off, you know, ultimately get off of antipsychotics, all sorts of medications they're on. When they realize, hey, no, if I just calm down and keep practicing and mature, eventually I will be able to get to this fourth phase and do that, and that will liberate me. I don't have to force it. I don't have to force it at all. I just have to be consistent. So the key, consistency is the key on the path. Not forcing it, consistency is the key. Keep doing it every day, every day, every day, every day. And you'll stay out of the mental hospital, psychiatric ward. You may feel a little unstable at times for sure, but you practice, they say, oh, I can practice today, sure, keep my practice going here. I always feel, you know, really so much compassion to those who are in mental hospitals or are having mental problems, etc., because I understand what that's about, and that does come from trying to force the issue. That means that there are very spiritual, usually people with mental problems are very spiritual. They're trying a lot, but they're not quite mature enough to understand, and they try to attack the ego or kill the ego or something like that, you know, and force the issue. That's not the way. That's not the way. Nobody has to kill the ego. Because they say, I know, I already know that I've already finished with the ego. I'm already finished with the ego. I don't have to attack the ego. I've already finished with the ego. I already know the ego's gone. I already know there is no ego. I already know that there's already no evidence for the ego whatsoever. So it's possible to practice this way, but only when you're mature enough to stay consistent with this and don't try to force it. See, if you know you can stay consistent with this, you're not going to try and force it. And sometimes I think I might forget this approach. And I think, oh my God, maybe I should just buy a case of Coca-Cola and stay up for the next 3 days and finish it. You know, I was even thinking that today. Maybe I just got to push this through. I said, no, I can stay consistent. I'm remembering this, you know. And I have the help, I believe, of some great teachers helping out. So, and of course the Holy Spirit is always there too. So I just have to say, no, I can stay with this. I'm not going to just forget it. I know I've already finished. See, I know I've already succeeded. I know I've already succeeded. One moment. So there you have it. This is why this is very auspicious. It's very helpful. My desire has always been to help those who are struggling with difficulty, having experienced it myself for sure. This is something that's very important. We're so immature. The culture is so immature in the West. Especially the United States. Some of the people in Europe are not so immature, not as immature as here in America, for sure. A lot of Europeans went to the East and gained some maturity. Americans, not as many. We're it's the wild, wild west out here. And this gets you into trouble. You get all these folks with their clever spirituality thinking they know ways to force the issue and et cetera, whereas as a matter of fact, it's consistency is the key. Not forcing it is the key. Knowing that there is this higher phase of practice, a leap of faith that you can get to. The consistency of your practice will lead you to that, you see. Then you can settle down and you're going to avoid the worst of it for sure. That doesn't mean it's going to be easy, but you're going to avoid the worst of it, which is what we want to do. Because the worst of it can be quite bad. So we want to avoid the worst of it. Just having great teachers in the world is so helpful, because they can just, you can meet them, and they can just assure you, don't worry, yeah, I see where you're at. You're doing fine. Don't force it. You know, you're making steady progress. Everything's okay. You're not quite ready yet for the highest teachings. That's fine. Don't worry. It's perfectly okay. Everybody goes through that. So you get reassured, and you know you meet someone who's there, already there, and they're saying, yeah, you're going to make it, don't worry. And then you kind of relax. You say, wow, okay, let me just try to be consistent then. It's super helpful to have enlightened beings in the world, super helpful. And here in the West, we don't even see the reason for that whatsoever. It's like nonsense to people, utterly ignorant. You know, you talk about sophisticated savages. This culture is a joke, for the most part. Really a joke. Bad joke. So many mentally sick people, and just throwing more and more medication at them. That's all. So, you know, I always prayed, you know, let there be great realized beings here in the West. And, you know, so far, you know, it hasn't really worked out that way. But I keep saying, you know, just because people are not ready for the, you know, fourth stage, that doesn't mean they can't be reassured, because they're not going to get to the fourth stage unless they're consistent, and they're not going to be consistent unless they realize they don't need to force the issue, and they're not going to realize they don't need to force the issue unless they realize there is this higher stage that they can get to, you know. So you need these teachers here, in my opinion. I've always been very adamant about that. I'm very upset that they're not these type of teachers in the West. You know, not the big, the real big shots like Ramana Maharshi. You know, they just, that those type of teachers help out enormously. Help out the entire culture. It's a cultural thing. Huge cultural thing. You know, pharmaceutical companies probably don't want those sort of teachers anywhere in the world if they can help it, actually. Healthcare industry probably doesn't want it. Teachers union probably doesn't want it. The whole culture probably doesn't even want it because they're too ignorant to realize how helpful it can be. They think that we're here to serve the culture. No, the culture is here to serve us. And we have an inverted right now in the Western paradigm, and in the global, new global paradigm, is that we think we're here to serve culture. That's not true. Culture exists only to serve us. And so if it's not serving us well, we have every right to say, well, let's change it so we have a culture that serves us well. And a culture that serves us well has to be one that emphasizes this higher teaching, the availability of this higher teaching, the success of this higher teaching, and that smooths out the spiritual path for everybody, phase 1, 2, 3, and 4. It smooths out for everyone. You can't have atheists running the show. Well, let me retract that. You can't have ignoramuses running the show. Atheists are not necessarily ignoramuses. They may just be saying that this imaginary God, which is a consultant we have imagined and how to trick God into this realm, they say that God doesn't exist, which is true. It's a product of our own imagination. Where they make a mistake is they say, therefore, no God exists. You know, that's folly for sure. But not all atheists are like that necessarily. I've never been bothered by atheists, so I don't have anything negative to say about them, really. Except they're trying to change all the laws. Some are trying to change all the laws, you know, that kind of thing, and get rid of God, which is not a smart thing to do, really. Not a smart thing to do. But some people are, you know, very intelligent atheists in terms of saying, I don't think that this universe, this world, is creation of God, which is true. It's not. So they're, you know, they're right about that. So there's the atheists can succeed too, because they can do this sort of practice, which is again to realize that none of this is real. It's all a dream. It's all hallucination. You know, you don't have to specifically ascribe to some personal form-based God to do this. You know, you just realize that. That there is a reality, there is a truth, there is a transcendent reality, transcendent truth, and you trust it, and have faith in it, and take the leap of faith. There's not some ideological, theological acid test for being able to do, you know, fourth phase practices. It could be an agnostic, it can be whatever, but you just realize that somehow intuitively, that this is what dispels hallucination, absolutely. By saying I've already dispelled hallucination. Hallucination, I already know that I've already dispelled hallucination. I already know that I've already dispelled all hallucination. But you cannot have ignoramuses running the world, which is what we have right now. This is big trouble, because you end up serving culture. you end up becoming a slave, a servant of culture, and their culture that does not allow for you, for your realization, you know, for your dispelling of hallucination. It does not. You're serving the hallucination. You end up serving the hallucination. You're a servant, a slave of the hallucination, of the whole presumption. There's nothing but a presumption, all of this. There's nothing but our spiritual presumption. You end up being a slave of a presumption. And this is what's coming in the world. So I said, hey, we need megawatt teachers in this world right now to reassure everybody, calm everybody down. The ego keeps loves to promote teachers who are not these mega teachers. One moment here, and they may be, you know, promoting those who are not, you know, the megawatt ones that really help, and say, yeah, this is it, this is it, this is the highest, this is the best, or something. And now, they may very well be doing that actually. That doesn't help either. That doesn't help either. Megawatt teachers help everybody. It's like a gigantic power station or something where it feeds energy to everybody, it feeds, empowers everybody. So I keep praying for that, keep praying for that. In the meantime, practice, practice, practice. But don't try to blast through the issue. Don't try, you know, full stop in the wow. Be patient with it. Every day's progress is enough for that day. And consistency is the key, and very great. That is it for this one.